Scientists have discovered a cave on the moon. It's the first time a cave's been found on the lunar surface, and it could potentially be an ideal location for humans to build livable bases. Joining us now is Rogier Windhorst. He's an astronomer at ASU School of Earth and Space Exploration. I'm going to call you Roger because it's a lot easier for me to pronounce
Roger,
that than
yet.
Okay. A cave has been discovered. What's going on here?
Looked like a crater, but with the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, there's a radar on board and a camera that Mark Robinson runs here at ASU, but the radar has seen the evidence for an underground lava tube, a cavity that leads to that crater. This is a fairly common phenomenon on Earth. We see it in Hawaii, Canary Islands, Iceland, and the moon once upon a time also had volcanic activity, and that may have left these cavities behind.
A couple hundred miles maybe from the Apollo 11 lunar
landing? Yeah, yeah.
Close, huh?
Mm-hmm, yeah. So if you want to go back there with a rover and eventually astronauts, you could think of building a habitat right at the entrance of the cave, you know.
You mentioned a lava tube. And I think it was like 130 some odd feet deep, so it's pretty considerable. But do you know what the sides are? Do you know the structure? Do you know?
Well, it must have been running liquid rock once upon a time that, you know, had more solid rock surrounding it when it cooled off, and then the lava eventually disappeared from the channel, and that left a cavity behind. That is not uncommon on Earth. It has happened, can have happened on the moon as well. So it could be a very long structure, actually.
Yeah, and no way of obviously knowing what's at the bottom or in the lower reaches.
No, just a spelunk, you know, just a cavity where you presumably could live and hide from the sun.
Okay, that's my next question.
Yeah.
The idea of this being kind of a base of operations for future human missions, exploration, is this realistic?
It's certainly possible. The moon is pretty hostile, right? Minus 200 Fahrenheit at night for 14 days, and then plus 250, twice the temperature of Phoenix, during the 14 days of sunlight. And so that's 400 some degrees different. So if you live at the entrance of that cave, you could be in the shade or in the heat, in the daylight as needed.
That's fascinating, the temperature up there. And we're taking a look right now.
Yeah.
This is the deal, right?
That's the one, yep. Yep.
And are there, do you think there are more of those up there?
There should be.
Was it a new kind of radar, a new kind of system that found this?
No, it's been the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter has had a radar on board all along that they used for imaging. But I think they now convinced themselves that there is this underground structure next to what you see here. This is just an opening, a crater, if you wish, but it's more like a volcanic sinkhole rather than an impact crater. Like all the others you see are impact craters where rocks hit the surface of the moon a long time ago. This one is really part of a system. We don't know how big it is, but if you could get to the bottom of it with ropes or eventually some technique like an elevator, it will take many lunar missions to implement that. But you would have, in principle, a place where it's more forgiving to live.
Is that the kind of thing that NASA is working on, those kinds of ideas? It sounds pretty far off into the future, but is it something that they're kind of working on now?
If we're going to live on the moon permanently, this would be one of the things to do. I would certainly love to explore that with a rover. Yeah,
I would think, though, there's something like if 130 feet deep and and you're wearing all your equipment and it's 100 and whatever outside or minus 100 and whatever, that would be difficult to get in and out of.
You mentioned
ropes.
You've backpacked with a 40-pound backpack, haven't you?
And
the moon, it's 1/6 of the gravity. You get 240 pounds on your back and that wouldn't mean nothing.
But you still got to get through. You still got
to
move.
Yes, you have to have ropes and you need to have good iron or steel cables to get down. It's not simple.
Okay. All things considered, though, how big a deal is this for science?
I think this is a big deal. I think this gives us a viable way to stay on the moon longer than a few days or a few weeks. This would offer the possibility to stay there for a long time if that's what we want to do. And that's the plan, of course.
Interesting. We got you here.
Yeah.
And I love talking about caves on the moon. Yeah. But the Perseids are coming up.
Oh, yes.
And I want to know more about the Perseids. And I think we should know more about them, especially those who can get out of town because it's so hard to see anything here in the valley.
Yeah.
What are the Perseids? When are they? Where are they?
A meteoroid storm, a sandstorm, if you wish, in the solar system. Basically, a cloud of dust particles left over by this comet, Swift-Tuttle, that has been going around the sun every 130 years or so. It came in 1865. It came back in 1992. At that point, it was in 1885 that it was recognized as a comet. A few years later, people realized that it was actually the source of these Perseids that around August 11, 12, create this beautiful spectacle of meteors hitting the upper atmosphere. And it's very consistent. It happens every August 11, 12, 13. And you can just go outside 87, go towards space, and not all that far, 4 feet.
Yeah, yeah.
Make sure there's a mountain between you and Phoenix. Bring a lawn chair, make sure there's no rattlesnakes, bring coffee. Go at 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, best time to do it. And look at the northeast. There will be this W-shaped constellation, Cassiopeia, right underneath it, a little harder to see, the Perseus constellation, and that dust cloud is draped in that direction, fixed in space. Just sit there and look. Every minute there will be one or two that will hit the upper atmosphere. You can't miss it.
And the path line always either starts or begins at or near Perseus.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, because that's where the cometary trail points at from our perspective.
Isn't that fascinating?
Yeah, it is.
But you got to get, it seems to me, I love looking at the stars in the wintertime. I love the winter stars and Orion and all that kind of, but in the summer, it just seems like when you're in the valley, there's nothing to see.
Yeah, and of course, in monsoons, in August we have,
yes.
But that's early evening. If you go late at night, past midnight, monsoons usually die down, that the sky will be very dark. You just look at the north-northeast, just look up in towards the northeast, lay on your lawn chair. You can't miss it.
You find one, you probably know where to keep looking.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. That will be very regular. Yes.
All right. Well, very good. We'll do that.
Yeah.
Rogier, great stuff.
Yeah.
I've always loved having you on, talking about the stars and perhaps caves on the moon.
Come to ASU to study it all.
Yeah, there we go. Thank you, sir. We appreciate it.
You're welcome.